Hello students, welcome to the first unit of inorganic chemistry. These first couple of slides are simply an introduction to what inorganic chemistry is. And so basically they're just going to provide you with some general information and we can take it from there. So let's have a look at this. We know that organic chemistry is the chemistry of life and will consist mostly of hydrocarbon compounds, while inorganic chemistry is the chemistry of everything else, which is the whole periodic table, including carbon. There are no sharp dividing lines between the subfields of chemistry, and many of the fields overlap completely. Okay, so what we will cover in this particular module is a very wide field of chemistry that's going to encompass coordination chemistry, where we're looking at metals that bind to nitrogen, oxygen, and sulfur, organometallics, where we can witness a metal to carbon bonds, bioinorganic chemistry, which is inorganic chemistry with some biochemistry, environmental chemistry, which is inorganic chemistry, and organic chemistry. So with organometallics, it's closely linked to organic chemistry, coordination chemistry, biochemistry, and environmental science fall under coordination chemistry. Bioinorganic chemistry has links to biochemistry itself. And then we have solid state chemistry, where we have material science and nanotechnology. So these four sort of subdivisions encompass the broad field of inorganic chemistry. Now, let's have a look at when we are going to compare bonds in organic chemistry versus inorganic chemistry. So if we looked at single bonds, yes, we get single bonds in both organic and inorganic compounds. We get double bonds and triple bonds as well. We don't find any kind of bonds that are higher than that, but we are able to note that we do get quadruple bonds. Quadruple bonds where there are four bonds. The coordination number, which we're going to look at in a later unit, is pretty constant. For organic compounds, the geometry is fixed, while for inorganic compounds, we're going to find that this coordination number is going to vary and the geometry is also going to be variable. Okay, so if we look again, look at some of the bonds that we are able to see here. Sorry, I just want to turn on a different pen for you so that we can see. I want to point out a few things. So in the first column over here, you're going to notice the organic bonds, some things that you've seen already. So these are single bonds over here. And you've got double bonds over here, and you've got triple bonds over here. If we looked at inorganic species, you're going to see we get a wide variety of different types of bonds, okay? And we're going to look at some of these. For example, if I looked at this particular one here, you will see that the tungsten has six bonds. There's bonds here, there's bonds around it. It becomes very, very complex. Okay. The types of bonding interactions, which we're going to look at, you know about sigma bonds, where two s orbitals overlap. We're looking at pi bonds, where two p orbitals overlap. And we look at delta bonds, which is something new to you guys, where the d orbitals overlap with one another. Okay, we get some typical geometries of inorganic compounds. You can see that they are vastly different to what you've been used to seeing. And what you've learned in your first year of chemistry, and some of them are very complex. Okay. Again, sometimes we see bonding interactions where metals will interact with aromatic ring systems. So we have a look at this particular molecule over here. This molecule here is called ferrocene. This one here is called chromine. And we have very complicated things which you can see on the right hand side, where we actually have interactions from these aromatic rings, Okay, so these are the aromatic rings over here. We have these interactions with the metal ions, the metal atoms themselves. And this is because the electron density is able to fill the orbitals of these metal atoms. But we'll deal more with that a bit later on. Okay, now I just want to refresh your memory with regards to the chemistry of carbon. Okay, so we have carbon has different allotropes. Remember what an allotrope is? It's a different chemical arrangement of a similar atom. So for example, if we look at diamond or graphite with carbon, the atoms can arrange themselves in a different way, giving us a different form of the material. So we know what diamonds are, we know what graphite is. We get something else called a Buckminster fullerene, where the carbon is able to arrange itself. There are 60 carbon atoms, so something like this on the left-hand side that I'm indicating over here. You will see that there you get different ways in which the carbon can arrange itself. Looks a lot like a soccer ball, actually. For those of you who follow soccer, you'll know that you get these six-membered rings over here. So there's a six-membered ring here and a six-membered ring here, and then these are five-membered rings. Pretty much a very similar pattern to what you see on a soccer ball. Okay, so these were discovered actually by an architect, to be honest with you, well, named after Buckminster Fuller, and he built something that looked like what you see in this picture on the right hand side over here, and it's a different allotrope of carbon. This is quite a complicated one. And yes, so let's have a look at some of the historical history of chemistry, as it were. There are many theories about the origin of the elements. Current opinion, scientific opinion, favors something called the Big Bang Theory, which is based on the Doppler effect that's observed in stars, where we get a redshift of spectral lines. So you can see on the picture on the right-hand side here, there was supposedly some kind of Big Bang that happened, and then now we have an expanding universe with stars and planets and galaxies and all sorts of things. Initially, there was only hydrogen and helium, and then as the temperatures dropped, the stars cooled, and this led to the formation of heavier elements. Okay, this just shows you a bit of a chart in terms of cosmic abundance of elements. You can see how abundant they are. Hydrogen and helium are probably the most abundant elements in the universe. And the chart sort of shows you other varying degrees to which there's abundance of various elements. We have the first draft of the periodic table, where in 1869, a scientist called Mendeleev came up with what the periodic table looked like. You can see in this photograph on the right-hand side over here that it was a very rough draft of how you put things together. And in fact, in 2019, we had the periodic table was sort of highlighted, and the year was claimed to be in the International Year of the Periodic Table. If you wish to visit the website, the link is given on the slide there for you. Okay. And so the modern periodic table, this is one which shows the actual element in its natural form. So we see we've got, like you can see some of the metals and some of the non-metals, gases and that kind of thing. So this is quite a unique periodic table. And if we go back to the history of inorganic chemistry, we back in 3000 BC, we have gold, silver, and copper were among the most common, as well as ceramics and glasses. And back then, things were called alchemy. So if you were a practicing chemist back in the day, you were classified as an alchemist. And there were many attempts made to change the base metals, silver, gold, mercury, all of those weird and wonderful things. But there were many attempts to change them into gold. And in these attempts, they found very many things. Back in the 17th century, we had common acids already being known. So hydrochloric, nitric, and sulfuric acid were already known. And by the end of the 19th century, the periodic table was proposed and early atomic theories were laid out. Coordination chemistry was developed towards the beginning of the 20th century. And then we had crystal field and ligand field theories were developed in the 1950s. Organometallic compounds were discovered in the mid-1950s. Titanium-based polymerization catalysts were discovered in 1955, and this became the start of the plastic era. And nowadays, we see many things about bio-inorganic chemistry recognized to be a major component of life. What are the important uses of inorganic chemistry? Well, we have catalysts, semiconductors, polymers, superconductors, magnetic materials, lubricants, nanostructures, and you can see the different uses and applications on the table on the right-hand side. Different types of compounds that have all of an application to what I've just mentioned. Okay, we've got fertilizers, paints, disinfectants, oxidants, water treatment, industrial chemicals, organic synthesis and pharmaceuticals, and even biology. If we look, this is my field of interest down here, bio-inorganic chemistry, where we look at things like vitamin B12, hemoglobin, iron sulfide proteins, chlorophyll. These are all compounds that contain a metal atom that is bound to various other compounds or elements that have biological relevance to us.